Congressman, the vote didn't happen last week, but this isn't over. Where do things stand from here? Where's your leverage? How do you keep pushing?
Well, I want to step back and build on something that you just said, and that is that we used to have two responsible governing parties in the United States, and I disagreed with the Republicans on a lot of things, but at the end of the day, they felt a sense of responsibility to the country. But at a moment when they're refusing to extend the debt limit, when the overwhelming majority of them are refusing to vote for a bipartisan highway, understand is that the well-being of the country is now exclusively on the shoulders of Democrats, and we have to do our work with a zero-vote majority in the Senate, with only three votes to spare in the House, which means all of us have to agree on this stuff to move forward. And that's not easy. It takes time. It requires negotiation. It looks messy, but I much prefer the messiness on our side to the forced conformity and irresponsibility on the other side.
Well, let's
talk. The next step.
Yes.
Yeah, so yes, the next step, very simply, is that we need to take the time to find consensus among Democrats on the second bill, on the Build Back Better bill. It's not going to be $3.5 trillion. We made a lot of progress in the last week at getting to a more realistic number. Now we have to figure out how do we get to that more realistic number? What are we prepared to sacrifice? What are our core priorities? And that's a healthy debate that we're going to have.
Then let's talk about that, because I feel like everything we're discussing is about whether we're going to spend or not spend, about the programs we want to fund. But I'm hearing very little about pay-fors. We're hearing almost nothing about closing tax loopholes. Right? There's not a lawmaker I speak to that ever says, oh, I really like the hookups for the private equity industry, the hookups for the real estate industry. But when it comes time to it, last I checked, carried interest is still in there. 1031 exchanges are still in there. Why aren't they being closed? Because that impacts the super rich, you know, the big donors.
I actually think there's a lot of agreement on pay-fors. Joe Manchin, who doesn't agree on everything, came out and said he's happy to raise the corporate tax rate. I think he supports a minimum corporate tax and an increase in the individual tax rate. And, you know, back home in my district, and this is what I really care about, I don't meet a single person, Republican or Democrat, who argues that Amazon should pay zero taxes. So this stuff is actually fairly popular among not just the Democratic base, but among the American people. And I think most members in the House and Senate will be supportive. I think given how much we can raise by doing those things, we have to have what is still a much harder debate about what priorities we're willing to fund within those limits. And that's what we're going to do. And I'm very calm about this. I believe we're going to be successful.
Does that mean we will expect to see things like the carried interest loophole for private equity closed and the 1031 exchange for massive real estate investment firms? Are those two things going to be closed? Because we always hear about Amazon, because that's a great headline. But I want to talk about that small group of super rich people that really get hooked up.
I hope so. I support those things. But to be frank, those are not the big revenue raisers. Those are things that are unjust. People are understandably upset about those aspects of the tax code. But that's not how we raise $1.5 or $2 trillion to be able to pay responsibly for the priorities for the investments in this bill. And one thing that ironically distinguishes us, I think, from the Republicans right now is that we do want to be fiscally responsible. We don't want to just push more money into the economy without raising revenue in a way that is responsible.
The one way you are looking to do it is raise taxes on families making $400,000 or more. In your state of New Jersey, there is pushback from those who are saying, what about the SALT deduction? We have very high property tax. You've said you want full restoration of that deduction. Where are we on that?
I strongly support full restoration of the SALT deduction, and I'm confident that if we get a budget reconciliation bill, that will be in the bill. I've made clear I can't vote for it if it's not. I've had many conversations with leadership, with folks in the House and the Senate. I'm confident that it will be there. So, you know, we were saying, a lot of us, no SALT, no deal. Right now, I've reversed that. It's no deal, no SALT. This is another reason why it's incredibly important to my constituents in New Jersey that we land both of these bills. We need the infrastructure. We need the jobs. We also need the SALT deduction and the investments in child care. lower drug prices. All of these things go together. And look, Democrats, we don't agree on all the priorities, but we do agree that it's incredibly important to the success of our democracy that we get this done. And that's why I believe we will.